Hello, I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to Why You. In the last several lectures, we introduced polynomial functions and said that their graphs can have many different interesting shapes. We showed that polynomial functions are built from a sum of one or more terms called monomials. Monomials with a single real variable have the form a times x to the nth power, where a is a positive or negative constant, and x is a real variable with a non-negative integer exponent. The terms of polynomials written in standard form are arranged so that the exponents decrease going from left to right. Therefore, the term with the largest exponent is always the leading term. Likewise, the coefficient of the leading term is called the leading coefficient. As we embark upon building polynomials, we will see that the leading term determines whether the function's graph will ultimately grow in the positive or negative direction as x takes on very large positive or negative values. This is referred to as the end behavior of the graph. As we saw in previous lectures, when writing monomials, it is not necessary to write x to the zero power, since in algebra, any variable with an exponent of zero, by convention, is considered to have a value of 1. Likewise, x to the first power is typically written without an exponent, since variables with no exponent have an implied exponent of 1. If we think of each monomial as a separate function, then a polynomial function can be thought of as a sum of these monomial functions. But how can adding various powers of x produce graphs with such a large variety of shapes? As we saw in the previous lecture, the graphs of powers of x are relatively simple. We also saw how a monomial's coefficient affects the shape of its graph by vertically stretching it or compressing it, or in the case of negative coefficients, reflecting it across the x-axis. So let's add some monomial functions and see what kind of graphs are produced. As an example, let's add x squared and x to the fourth power. This produces a polynomial with two terms, otherwise known as a binomial. When we add functions, the value of the resulting function is the sum of the individual functions at each value of x. For example, when x equals 1, both functions have a value of 1. Therefore, the value of the function x to the fourth power plus x squared is 1 plus 1, or 2. Doing this for every value of x produces the graph of the polynomial function x to the fourth power plus x squared. This function doesn't look much different from the graphs of the two functions we added. But let's see what happens if we change the coefficient of x to the fourth power to negative 1. When we add these two monomials, we get the polynomial function negative x to the fourth power plus x squared, producing a more interesting graph. Even though both monomial functions intersect the x-axis at a single point, the polynomial function intersects the x-axis at 3 points. This is because there are 3 different x values where the sum of the 2 monomial functions is 0. For example, when x is 0, both functions have a value of 0. Therefore, their sum also has a value of 0. Likewise, for the 2 monomial functions, when x is 1, or negative 1, the sum of the 2 functions is also 0, producing 2 additional zeros for the polynomial function. Taking a closer look at the graph of this polynomial function, we see that the function has positive values for x greater than 0 and less than 1, and for x less than 0 and greater than negative 1. This is because for x values in this range, the magnitude of x squared is greater than the magnitude of negative x to the 4th power. For example, when x is 1/2, negative x to the 4th power is negative 1/16, and x squared is 1/4. The function's value is thus negative 1/16 plus 1/4, or positive 3/16. On the other hand, for x values greater than 1, or less than negative 1, the value of the polynomial function becomes negative. This is because for that range of x values, the magnitude of x squared is smaller than the magnitude of negative x to the 4th power. For example, when x is 2, negative x to the 4th power is negative 16, and x squared is 4. The function's value is thus negative 12. So by adding these 2 monomial functions, we produce the graph with a more complicated shape. As x gets further from the origin, the graph initially grows in the positive direction, but then reverses direction, becoming negative. From then on, negative x to the 4th power increases much faster than x squared, causing the graph's end behavior to grow without limit in the negative direction. As we mentioned earlier, we can always predict the end behavior of a polynomial function's graph by looking at the end behavior of the leading term. The leading term in this case is negative x to the 4th power. Since the end behavior of the leading term becomes infinitely negative for both positive and negative x, the end behavior of the polynomial does so as well. So let's see if it's possible by adding a 3rd monomial term with a larger exponent to make the graph change directions a 2nd time, once again curving upward. Let's try adding x to the 6th power to our polynomial and see how this affects the function's graph. Adding this term to the polynomial produces a graph that looks quite similar to the graph of x to the 6th power. Perhaps this is because x to the 6th power grows so fast that it overpowers the other terms in the polynomial. However, we can try mitigating this by choosing a coefficient for this additional term with a value smaller than the implied coefficient of 1. So let's see what happens when we reduce the value of this coefficient. Thank you. With a coefficient of 2/10, the effect of this new term is reduced enough to allow each term to control the direction of the graph over some range of x values. As x gets further from the origin, the graph first switches from a positive to a negative direction, and then reverses a second time, heading back in the positive direction. No matter how small we make the coefficient, since the leading term determines the graph's in behavior as x takes on large positive or negative values, the graph will continue to grow infinitely in the positive direction, since the leading term x to the 6th power does so as well. So far, by combining the two monomial functions x squared and negative 1 times x to the 4th power, we were able to make the graph reverse directions, first growing in the positive direction, and then in the negative direction. We then added a third term, 2/10 times x to the 6th power, producing a graph that reverses direction twice, first heading in a positive direction, then reversing direction becoming negative, and then reversing direction again, with its end behavior becoming infinitely positive. So let's see if by adding more terms, we can produce a graph with even more changes of direction. We will start with the monomial x squared, and add negative x to the 4th power with a coefficient of negative 0.12. Next, let's add x to the 6th power with a coefficient of 0.004. Let's then add negative x to the 8th power with a smaller coefficient, and finally x to the 10th power with an even smaller coefficient. But instead of increasing the number of changes in direction in our graph, this new term eliminated the previous change in direction. This is because as we get further from the origin, x to the 10th power increases so much faster than the other powers of x in the polynomial, that it overpowers the changes in direction caused by some of the other terms. However, by a process of trial and error, the other coefficients can be readjusted so that each term contributes a positive or negative change in direction, producing a graph with even more peaks and valleys. We have seen how a polynomial function's graph can be affected by its individual monomial building blocks. Our next challenge, given a particular polynomial function, is to produce that function's graph. There are computer programs and electronic calculators that are capable of creating accurate graphs of polynomial functions. However, when those devices are not readily available, it is often desirable to sketch a quick representation of a function's graph to get an idea of its general behavior. In the next lecture, we will see how this can be accomplished.